Praise God. It's so good to be together again. You and me in Christ Jesus. We're together. It doesn't matter where we are, but we are together in Christ Jesus. You know, the Word of God says in Isaiah 55, verse 11, it says that God sends forth His Word and it always accomplishes. It never returns empty or void, but always accomplishes what He's purposed. And you know, God's plans and purposes for you and me are not evil, but good, to do you good, to bless us. So right now, let's just welcome the Holy Spirit to activate the Word of God in our hearts. Precious Holy Spirit, we're so thankful that God the Father has you on assignment to activate His promises, His goodness, His gifts in our lives. We need you every day, every hour, night and day. We need you, and we just welcome you right now in our homes, our cars, wherever we are, just to breathe on the Word of God and cause it to be activated in our lives for the glory of God. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Casting your care. Oh, why does that even matter, Pastor Stephen? Casting your care. We're about to find out. It's a big deal. You know, sometimes care and worry can be so overwhelming, you don't even want to get out of bed. You just, like, you hit the alarm clock, you're like, I don't even want to get out of bed. You know, one Sunday morning, this mom went into her son's bedroom and she said, hey, it's time to wake up. It's time to go to church. Her son groaned, rolled over and said, Mom, no way. I'm not going to church again today. No, sir. And she answered back. She goes, what do you mean you're not going to church? And he said, Mom, I'm going to give you two good reasons. Number one, I don't even like those people. Number two, they don't like me. She tapped her foot impatiently, as moms can do, and she scolded him, saying, son, that's no excuse. I'm going to give you two better reasons why you need to get up and go to church. She said, number one, you're 45 years old. Number two, you're the pastor of the church, for Pete's sake. He had a little bit of a care worry problem. Thank God for moms, even at 45 years old. Look, God has a gift for you today. He's got a gift for you today, but you're going to have to give up something to receive it. That's right. You're going to have to give up something to receive the gift. You know, Pam, my wife, is always quoting that proverb that says, the blessing of the Lord makes truly rich, and He adds no sorrow with it, neither can toiling increase it. And in other words, the gifts, the blessings of God are without strings attached. But there are requirements of receiving. God needs you to activate your faith to receive it. Did you hear that? You're going to have to give up to go up. Give up to go up. More precious than silver or gold, my friend. God has wisdom for you that's going to transform your life, my life. Man, we need to just dig in and receive that wisdom from heaven. God, your Father, wants to give you a gift today. His special gift when you cast your care. And you're going to find out that that's the requirement to receiving this gift. You know, there are times in life when we encounter trials that seem overwhelming, crushing. The enemy's tactic is to distract, to engage us in worry to such an extent that we are so focused on the problem that not even one little bit of our thought process can be dedicated toward God's power and His solutions. We're focused on the crisis. We're focused so much on the care that instead of looking at God's provision, His protection, we can't see the gift that's right in front of us. There's an old saying that goes like this. It says, just when the caterpillar thought the world was ending, he turned into a butterfly. Could it be that you feel like the world is ending, but you're right on the threshold of turning into a butterfly, something beautiful that God has already planned and ordained? Could it be that the pressure is actually giving birth to something beautiful and brand new in your life? So often there is treasure in the trial. So often there are diamonds in the darkness, but care disallows the gift. Care rejects the gift of God. Have you ever had a stressful thing happen that would tempt you to worry, to care, to be anxious? I mean, have you ever got that phone call with such bad news, such sad news? Just recently, my good friend the other day, he got such tragic news in a phone call? Have you ever had problems at work or a big worry over what the boss thinks or maybe even what the team thinks? A concern for someone that you dearly love. Oh, that's a big one. Maybe it's a son, a daughter. Maybe you're concerned about your mom or your dad and they're in a crisis. Maybe you've heard that voice even in the middle of the night. So what are you going to do now? What are you going to do about that? Well, what are you going to do about this problem? What are you going to do? What are you going to do? And it's over and over. And now you're losing sleep. You're suffering from sleep deprivation, the very thing that agencies use to torture people, their prisoners, to get information. It's one of the enemy's favorite torture techniques to cause you to suffer, to be distracted. But my friend, there is good news. God has the answer for you. He is the answer for you. Right now, just take a few moments. Let's not do this a long time, but take a few moments just to mentally identify your main source of care. What are you worried about? What are you stressing about? What is causing you anxiety, maybe interrupting your sleep? Is it maybe your personal health and well-being? Maybe it's your family safety, finances. That's a big one. Maybe it's just the future, the global world condition and the future of could be the world or even just your community. You know, a recent Gallup poll said that 60% of adults have an unprecedented increase in stress and care right now. That's 53 million people in the United States and almost 20 million people in Canada. Oh, Canada. That's a lot of troubled, anxious, sad, mad, freaking out people whom God dearly loves. You know, the National Institute of Mental Health recently published data saying that about 30% of teen girls, 20% of teen boys, that's 6.3 million teens, have some kind of anxiety disorder. People, that's an epidemic of care. I mean, that's an epidemic of care that we just can't humanly manage. We need help. And some professionals, thank God for our mental care professionals, but some professionals do their best by just promoting coping techniques. It's the best they've got, and even medication. But God actually wants to solve this problem for us. And He really does have the solution. Look, when you feel adrift, God has a gift for you, but not just for you, it's also to bless others. The blessing God wants to get to you is for you, but it's also so that you can be a conduit. You can be a gateway for the kingdom to bless many other people. My dear friend, Dr. Don Colbert, he was telling me not so long ago that the number one killer in North America is stress, worry, fretting, care. More than car accidents, more than any other kind of sickness, it's long-term stress. You know, the symptoms can range from headaches, elevated blood pressure, chest pain, insomnia, to mental health disorders, ulcers, skin problems, heart disease, inflammation, autoimmune disease, dangerous spikes in your cortisol level, and on and on and on. Care is quietly crushing people, killing people. Dale Carnegie said this, you know, the famous author, lecturer, and pioneer in the world of psychology of success. He said this, our fatigue is often caused not by work, but by worry, frustration, and resentment. Care is such a complex construct of mental engineering. It's complicated. It leads to death, but it seems so noble in its cause. But God has the antidote. Did you know God has the cure for our care? He is the solution, praise God. He is peace in the storm. In fact, when we've got big trouble, God shows up with a gift for you. A gift for you. Yes, a big gift. Let's take a look at 1 Peter 5, verses 6 and 7. Look at this. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due season. Verse 7, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Now, I want to read that one more time because I want you to see something where the commas are. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, comma, that He may exalt you in due season. Now, the sentence isn't done, comma, casting all your care upon Him, for he cares for you. Pastor Stephen, what's that mean? It means that the comma connecting verse 6 to 7, it's a full thought. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. How? By casting all your care upon him. Do you see that? Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, comma, that he may exalt you in due season. In other words, God can't exalt you until you humble yourselves. But how do we do that? Comma, verse 7, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. See, this is not about being careless. You know, that bad attitude, but rather it's about being free of care, carefree. To be careless implies a bad attitude that's void of empathy, kindness, love. It's just self-centered and selfish. But being carefree, free of that worry and care, is the outcome of intentionally trusting what's precious. A lot of our cares are precious to us. When we intentionally trust what's precious to our great God, it means trust. It's not about being self-centered and having this do-nothing attitude, but rather it's about doing the right thing. The right thing moves the mountains. Instead of allowing the mountains to just crush us, we activate faith to move the mountains. When I was a boy, I have to confess to you, I was a professional, careful worrier. I was full of care, worry, and anxiety. I was advanced in being careful. Advanced in it. I was raised by a single mom. Yes, life was tough. We moved a lot. And when I say moved a lot, we moved sometimes 1,000, 1,200 miles. I mean, these were big moves, big cultural changes. My dad was a drug addict. He was a very immoral man. So there was a lot of shame and humiliation attached to my young life. Normal seemed to be We were always in a major crisis. I was having panic attacks at 6 years old. I didn't even know what they were until I was in my 20s and somebody began describing panic attacks, a professional, and the symptoms. And I was like, I've been having these all my life. At 6 years old, I was having full-on panic attacks, worried about my dad, worried about his eternity. I'd lay awake at night, unable to go to sleep because I was worried about the future. I was worried about my family, my siblings, our safety, the bills that were overdue, my mom's health. I didn't want to lose. We had already lost my dad. I didn't want to lose my mom too. I started having thyroid problems. I was sad, frustrated. I was angry. I was worried, careful. You know, there's a Turkish proverb that says this. It is worms which destroy a tree. It is worry which destroys a man. I can tell you this, worry even eats little boys and girls. I know what it's like to feel like I was dying from the inside out. The word care in 1 Peter 5, verse 7, is translated from the Greek word merimna, which means through the idea and force of distraction, you are drawn in different directions. You are careful, anxious. It's related to the root of being thoughtfully pulled and torn in different directions by worry. Think about it, like in the old cowboy days, they used to talk about, you know, the punishment of being drawn and quartered, hooking you up to 4 different horses and just pulling you apart. That's what worry does to us. That's the true Greek word that we talk about when it says cast your cares. It's the stuff that pulls you apart from the inside out. So think of it this way. We often shorten the idea of care to being just thoughtful. I have regard for you. I have care for you. But we've left off a critical part of the meaning. It's to be thoughtfully drawn apart in different directions. Does that seem familiar in any way to you, to be ripped apart from the inside out? Whoever thought that that was a good idea to admit out of the meaning, to admit out of the full meaning? Apparently, there is an enemy of our soul who is happy about seeing us drawn and quartered and torn apart. But praise God, our Heavenly Father, He's got a better plan for you and me. He's got gifts for you and me. And it's not to be torn apart. It's not to be tortured. Oh, did you hear that? Worry, care, and anxiety are not part of God's master plan for your life. Well, what is God's will for me, Pastor Stephen? What's God's will for you? You know, I thought being full of care was being responsible. Well, I used to think exactly the same way. I had no understanding at all of what 1 Peter 5 was saying, that God's will is to lift me, to exalt me. Oh my goodness, that just seems unimaginable. I wrongly thought that humility was living under, not over. Being exalted, that was bad. That was pride. So being worried about family, finances, and the future, that was being responsible. Being worried and full of care, burdened and sad, that was godly, I thought. Well, we don't have much. We go from one crisis to the next, but at least I'm doing the right thing. I'm worrying. Right, God? Am I? See, you can be sincere, but you can be sincerely wrong. As a little boy, I was sincerely wrong. As a teenager, oftentimes I was sincere, but sincerely wrong. Well, I'm worrying, fretting, and doing what the Lord's asked me to do. Nope, you're not. It's not truth. It's not the truth. You see, that's the great deception. Jesus is not asking us to do that. And we can't do this claiming to be obedient and hoping at least that our sacrifice to Him, that somehow it'll produce something good, because it's actually disobedience. So let's get back to this whole casting your care being the true definition of humility. Notice I said your care, because 1 Peter 5 verse 7 says, casting all your care upon Him. Because letting go of your care and trusting in God, my friend, that's weighty. That's true humility. That really is being humble. Trust really means to be careless. Think about it. If you put your money in a good bank, a trustworthy institution, you're careless about it. You take your $100 and you deposit it, and then you don't think about it that night. It doesn't mean that you still don't value your deposit, but you shouldn't have to take care for it night and day, hoping that it's safe. Now, of course, your trust should be in proportion to the integrity and capability of the trustee. Now, what's that mean? That means that you fully trust your contractor to remodel your kitchen, but that doesn't mean you should trust them to do eye surgery, right? And your contractor right now is like, oh, I don't even know how to spell glaucoma. We definitely can trust in God, but do we? How can we humble ourselves under God's mighty hand if we don't trust Him? Oh, Pastor Stephen, I love the Lord. I really love the Lord. Yes, yes, but do you really trust Him? Let's go back to 1 Peter 5, and let's start at verse 5 through 7. Look at this. Be clothed with humility, for God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. Well, I mean, we just heard God wants to give grace. I mean, that's unmerited favor, blessing, what we don't deserve. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due season, comma, casting all your, He might as well say, by casting all your care upon Him, all your anxieties, your worries, your concerns, once and for all, for He cares for you affectionately and cares for you watchfully. You see, my friend, worry amplifies the problem, but humility, oh, look at this, humility receives the gift. Oh, I want to receive this gift. Yes, I do. The gift of grace. God's lifting you. Here's the truth. This is God's will for your life. We all want to know God's will for your life. I'm going to give you God's will for your life. God wants to give you grace, His amazing gift. God needs you to humble yourself under His hand so that He can exalt, promote you. I want to show you what this looks like. See, this is you humbling yourself. See, when you take this lid, represents your cares. Oh, I want the gift. And God says, humble yourself so that I can lift you. I can exalt you. And you're like, oh, I want the gift. But you see, what happens is we want to keep the gift. Let's just keep the lid of care on here. And until we take the lid of care off and cast it off on Him, we don't come fully under His hand. Oh, there you are. Look, and as you're under God's hand, He's able to exalt you. He's able to lift you. But until this happens, you're under the lid of care, and God, His agenda is, oh, I want to lift Stephen. I want to lift Mary. I want to get her above that situation. Oh, I know she cares for her family, but I want to lift her above the cloud of this situation and get her to a place where she's more effective as a conduit of heaven in her life and in their life. But she's got the care. She won't trust me with the care. She seems to think that I don't care about her care, and God wants to care about your care. But until we humble ourselves, and He defines humility as casting your care upon, it doesn't mean that your cares aren't valuable, but when you trust Him with your cares, now suddenly you come under His hand. And look at what's happened. God is able to exalt you, to lift you, to promote you. And when He does that, you become more effective, not just in your life, but in everybody's life. You become more effective in the kingdom of God. When you pray, your prayers are more effective. They touch heaven because you don't have this thing called care in the way, which ultimately represents even your disobedience, your lack of trust. God needs you. I said it before. God needs you, requires you to humble yourself under His mighty hand so He can exalt you and promote you. Oh, my friend, see, that's a picture of you humbling yourself. You make a trust choice to let go, submit to His hand, and go up. You see, this is not about circumstances humiliating you or you submitting to an abuser. No, no. It's trusting in God and His power to not only lift you, but to gift you, but to take care of all your cares. What? That's right. To take care of all. Look, God can do a better job of taking care of this lid by far than you can ever. I mean, this lid being on your head doesn't help you. Being in your head, bouncing through your thoughts. Oh, but you don't understand, Pastor Stephen. My little girl is sick, and I don't want anything for me, just for her. But I want you to understand. You casting your care on the Lord is you trusting God with your little girl. And that act of humility places you and her under God's hand. But now exalted above the problem, because God wants to lift your thinking, lift your thought process above the clouds of the worry and the care and the fretting, above the situation, and you can do more. Trusting in God for your little girl, trusting in God and empowered, than being weak, troubled, double-minded, fragile, and falling apart. Your little girl doesn't need you breaking on the inside. Casting your care is not stripping value from the person or situation that you care for. It's you entrusting that thing or person to God and at the same time allowing Him to lift you. Winston Churchill said this. He said, "Let our advanced worrying become advanced thinking and planning." Well, how can you do that when you're under the influence of worry and care? None of us can. Humility is complete submission and trust in God, in the truth. When we insist on our position of care, it's an act of antitrust toward God that esteems our ability above His power to help, to save, to provide, to care, and so that short circuits the true anointing, your true promotion. You are anointed to love, but friend, you will never be empowered to carry your care. That's the way God designed it. You're empowered to pray, but you're never going to be empowered to be careful. You're called to be compassionate, kind, to help and to serve, but not to be full of worry and care. You're called to forgiveness, mercy, and truth, but not worry, fretting, and a life heavy with care. Never care less, but always free of care and worry. Just like vengeance is never yours. Romans 12:19 says, vengeance belongs to the Lord. It's never going to be your ministry to take vengeance. It belongs to God. Look at Matthew 11:29-30. Jesus said this. He said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Then he goes on and he says this, "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." We need to exchange our lid over the potential of our life for the yoke and the burden of Jesus, which actually anoints us and helps promote us. See, God doesn't want there to be nothing on top of our head, but His wonderful guiding hand, God's hand leading us, guiding us, protecting us, covering us. But you can't substitute God's hand for the lid of care and worry. This is Jesus talking, and he says that his yoke is easy, his burden is light. What's yours like right now? Here's an easy test. Have your burdens and cares ever given rest or renewal to your soul? Has worrying about your family or job ever given you a blessed quiet to your mind or given you a promotion? Do you feel less anxious or more anxious obsessing over your cares? If you're being honest right now, you know your cares are squashing the life out of you. So the big question really is, are you willing to give up to go up? To give up your cares to God and say, I trust you, Lord. You've got to give up to go up. Your care and worry are acting like a lid on God's will for your life. He owns the ministry of handling your cares. It's his ministry to you and for you. So you will never be empowered. Listen to this. You will never be empowered to handle your cares except to cast them. That makes you all me-centered when it's all about your cares, even in a responsible way. Unknowingly selfish, unknowingly weak, disadvantaged, yes, powerless. But when you take care, you substitute your legal God advantages for being spiritually disadvantaged. How, Pastor Stephen? You're illegally trying to carry something God said not to. Most of the time, this is because of ignorance and not intentional. But the outcome is the same. It's death. Yes, people die carrying care, worry and anxiety that they're not empowered to carry. Remember David the shepherd boy? He didn't worry about the giant. He reverenced God's name. King Saul was full of care about the giants, and he couldn't do anything about the threat. David's big, experienced soldier brothers cared about the giant. They could do nothing about the threat. The whole Israeli army was worried and troubled by the giant. They could do nothing. David refused the epidemic of giant fear because instead he held to his reverence for God and the name of God, and he was empowered to drop the giant in his tracks like a bag of potatoes. Hallelujah! David's refusal to take care, worry, and anxiety empowered the entire Israel army that day, and they defeated the armies of the Philistine. Look at this. David humbled himself and he got his gift from God. He refused the lid of care. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that amazing? Praise God. Refuse the lid of care. How about Joseph, the son of Jacob? He was hated by his brothers, sold into slavery, falsely accused. I mean, that's something to care about. But he didn't let care take over his mind. He kept thinking about the dreams that God gave him, the vision God gave him. Because Joseph kept refusing the lid of care, worry, and fretting, and resentment, God was able to promote Joseph from the prison into the palace and into the highest position of leadership. When a worldwide famine was causing even the strongest people to panic, like his brothers, Joseph stayed carefree, lid free. Under God's hand, Joseph even prospered when the whole world was starving, and that put him in a place to be able to save many, many, many lives, including the lives of his brothers and his father. As we've learned, your care comes from the Greek word merimna, which means through worried distraction, you're drawn and quartered in different directions. You're pulled apart. A divided focus will always work against you and work to pull you apart and divide you and break you. But that's not God's will for your life. God's called you to a rest. Jesus said he has a rest for the weary. Look at Matthew 11, verses 28 and verse 30. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Carefree living is anointed, powerful living. It's yoke is easy, burden is light living. That's the truth. You may be in a crisis right now with overwhelming burdens you're carrying. You've heard me say, but I need to repeat this again. Letting go of your cares does not diminish the value or worth of who or what is weighing your heart down. But the threefold gift here that 1 Peter 5, verses 6 and 7 present for us is this. Number one, casting your cares on the Lord gets you out from under the crushing weight that God will never anoint you to carry anyway. You can sacrifice, but it's disobedience to God. So what's the point? On the other side, you're dying slow and you're being of no use to the agenda of care anyway. So number one, casting your care on the Lord gets you out from under the crushing weight. Number two, casting your care on the Lord puts the important care into the hands of God, who can actually do the impossible. If I was the one that you were caring about and carrying around in your heart, no offense, but I'd rather be in God's capable, miraculous, anything is possible hands than to be in your best, most well-intentioned, but stressed out, overwhelmed human hands. I want to be in God's hands. So does your family. So do your finances. So does your job. So does your future, your dreams. They need to be in God's hands. And number three, casting your cares on the Lord is an act of humility that makes it so that He can exalt you. God can exalt you until you cast your care. That's what he said in 1 Peter. This is God's wonderful will for your life, not just a promotion, but being above so you can be a blessing to others. Don't you want to be a blessing to others? I know you do. God's got this wonderful gift for you. He's got this wonderful gift for you, his promotion, his lifting, but you can't get your balloon off the ground with this crushing weight on your head. God can't promote disobedience. It would go against his character. That's a refusal to humble yourself. But the moment you humble yourself, you come under his wonderful, beautiful, caring hand, and God is able to lift you above the clouds. That's where you're supposed to be. Oh, Pastor Stephen, I want this. I want this 1, 2, 3 you just described. I don't want to be crushed or broken. My family needs me. I want that rest that Jesus offers. And I don't want to miss out on God promoting me because I really want to be a blessing to those around me. You're right. God can handle these problems, these cares, 1,000,000 times better than I ever could. My friend, make Jesus the Lord of your life right now. Just do it. You can't trust your heavy cares to someone that you haven't authorized to be the king of your life. Jesus is waiting for you to ask him to come into your heart as Lord and Savior, but only you can license such a transaction of faith. Only you. Friend, this is a turning point. You need God's help right now. Pray this with me. Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of all my sins. You are the Son of God, born of the Blessed Virgin Mary. You lived the perfect, sinless life. You died on the cross to pay my sins. After 3 days, the Spirit of God rose you up again. You reign above all rule and power. Your name is above every other name. Help me surrender all my cares into your hands. Jesus, be my Lord. Amen. Wow, you just put your whole life into the King of Kings' hands. Wow, that's beautiful. And you just surrendered everything and everyone that's precious to you. That's beautiful. All your worries, cares, and concerns, you gave over to Jesus. But as good as that sounds, it's not a one-time thing, my friend. It's a lifestyle that you have to be trained in so that you can live life strong. You hear me and Miss Pam say it all the time. You got to live life strong. We've got inspired tools based on God's word to help encourage you, direct you, and give you practical applications so that you can learn the habits of walking carefree. It needs to become a habit. Living carefree with Jesus as your Lord. So part two of this series is coming up. We will talk more about how to apply this truth to your life and keep receiving this big, beautiful gift.